Good morning and welcome. I felt like we needed to sing a little bit more today, so we're going to sing three songs. All this joy, all this sorrow, all this promise, all this pain, such is life, such is being, such is spirit, such is love. City of joy, city of sorrow, city of promise, city of pain. Such is life, such is being, such is spirit, such is love. World of joy, world of sorrow, world of promise, world of pain. Such is life, such is being, such is spirit, such is love. All this joy, all this sorrow, all this promise, all this pain, such is life, such is being, such is spirit, such is love. Reverend Fred Kirkpatrick wrote this song, Everybody's Got a Right to Live, in the 60s during the civil rights movement then. And it's become kind of a theme song for the Poor People's Campaign, their current campaign that's coming up on next Saturday, the Moral Assembly. Everybody's got a right to live. Everybody's got a right to live. And before this campaign fails, we'll all go down to jail. Everybody's got a right to live. Everybody's got a right to dream. Everybody's got a right to dream. And before this campaign fails, we'll all go down to jail. Everybody's got a right to dream. Everybody's got a right to learn. Everybody's got a right to learn. And before this campaign fails, we'll all go down to jail. Everybody's got a right to learn. Everybody's got a right to live. Everybody's got a right to live. And before this campaign fails, we'll all go down to jail. Everybody's got a right to live. Reverend Sekou is a theologian, he's a documentary filmmaker, and he's an amazing songwriter and performer. And this song has been out in the streets now for a few years, and it's still being sung everywhere. What a time to be alive. What a time to be alive. The revolution has come. What a time to be alive, what a time to be alive. When we stand up, we've already won. What a time to be alive, what a time to be alive. The revolution has come. What a time to be alive, what a time to be alive. When we stand up, we've already won. We've won, we've won, we've won, we've already won. We've won, we've won. When we stand up, we've already won.
Good morning. And welcome to White Bear Unitarian Universalist Church. We're grateful to share this space with you. Service participants today are Carol Coulette, Victoria Stafford, and Amy Peterson Derrick, supported by Reverend Jack Gady, Anna Garris, and Aaron Scott. Today, right after the service, you're invited to join with each other for Cyber Social Hour. Come for informal conversation and meet friends old and new. Aaron will put the Zoom link and easy instructions in the chat box. If you're new to our congregation and interested in membership, you're warmly invited to join Reverend Jack Gady and Victoria Stafford for our membership class tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Watch the e-news email for a Zoom link, or visit our website, or send us an email to find the meeting. And a reminder, the annual meeting of White Bear UU Church will take place next Sunday via Zoom. You'll find the agenda, annual report, and other materials on our website or in the e-news, or you can email the church office. Please feel free to contact President Alex Bartlett or Treasurer Jim Van Ostrand with questions about the budget or other business to come before the meeting. If you or someone you know requires paper copies, or if you need help with Zoom, please call or email us. We are here to help. You'll see information on the chat box now about our weekly offering and how to text to give. This will also be up on a slide a little later, but we welcome your gifts at any time. Welcome to our church. Together, we grow our souls and serve the world.
Come in. Come into this space which we make holy by our presence. Come in with all your vulnerabilities and strengths, fears, anxieties, loves, and hopes. For here you need not hide nor pretend, nor be anything other than who you are and who you are called to be. Come into this space where we can heal and be healed, forgive and be forgiven. Come into this space where the ordinary is sanctified, the human is celebrated, the compassionate is expected. Come into this space, together we make it a holy space. Gloria Ferguson and her family will light the chalice.
Hi, I'm Gloria, and this is my daughter Annie and my grandson Stanley and Wade.
You look at the camera, Wade?
Today we're going to light the chalice for all the things that kisses make better. When you think about it, that's a lot of things.
Happy.
You say happy kisses?
Happy kisses!
Happy kisses!
Happy kisses!
I guess
so. Give me a kiss.
Join me in our opening words. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Join me now in singing.
That song for the loving of the world, that we may love as one. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our loving. With every voice, with every song,
morning. This morning's story is called The Three Questions, and it's adapted by a story written by Leo Tolstoy. There once was a king who wanted more than anything in the world to be kind and just. As he pondered this, it occurred to him that if only he always knew just the right time to begin everything, if only he knew who were the most important people to listen to, and above all, if he only always knew what the most important thing to do, then he could indeed be a kind and just ruler. And so the king made a great proclamation throughout his kingdom that he would give a great reward to anyone who could teach him the answers to these most important questions. When is the right time? Who is the most important one? And what is the most important thing to do? And so the people came from all over the kingdom to answer this question. When is the right time? He first asked of his people. As they answered in turn, the king listened and found that there were as many different answers as there were people in the crowd. Some said that to know the right time for every action, one must make a plan and live strictly according to it. Others still said that no one person could know everything, so that it was important to have a circle of wise friends to help make decisions. Others said that there was no way to know unless you could see into the future. And so to answer this question, you must be a magician. But the king wasn't so sure. And so after hours and hours of listening to answers, the king decided to ask his second question. Who is the most important one? Equally varied were the answers to the second question. Some said that the most important people are those who make all the laws. Some said that those who are the strongest are the most important. And others said that maybe it's the healers or the wealthy among us. Well, the king hoped that his third question might prove a little easier. What is the most important thing to do? Yet again, the king was overwhelmed with so many opinions. Some replied that the most important thing in the world was science. Others said it was skill in warfare. Others said it was knowledge, and some said power, and some said status. All the answers being different, the king agreed with none of them and gave the reward to none. But still wishing to find the right answers to his questions, he decided to ask a teacher who lived in the nearby wood who was known far and wide as the wisest teacher of the age. When the king approached the teacher's hut, the wise teacher was digging in the ground, creating a garden. Seeing the king, the teacher greeted him, but then went right on digging. The king was surprised to find that the teacher was weak and tired and breathed heavily with each turn of the spade into the earth. The king went up to the teacher and said, "I have come to you, O wise one, to ask you three questions. When is the right time? Who is the most important one? And what is the most important thing to do?" The wise teacher listened to the king, but answered nothing. The teacher just kept right on digging. "I can see you're tired," said the king. "Let me take the spade and work a while for you." "Thanks," said the teacher, and giving the spade to the king, sat down on the ground. When the king had completed two beds, the king stopped and repeated his questions. And again, the teacher gave no answer, but rose and stretched out a hand for the spade and said, "Now rest a while and let me work a bit." But the king did not give back the spade. Instead, he continued to dig. 1 hour passed, and another. The sun began to sink behind the trees, and the king at last stuck the spade into the ground and said, "I came to you, wise teacher, for an answer to my questions. If you can give me none, just tell me so, and I will return home." "Just a moment," said the teacher. "I think I can hear someone running. Let us see who it is." The king turned around and saw a man running out of the wood. He had clearly been injured. When he reached the king, the man fell, fainting, onto the ground. The king and the teacher worked quickly together to tend to the injured man. Together they washed and bandaged the wound, and at last the man revived and asked for something to drink. The king brought fresh water and gave it to him. Meanwhile, the sun had set and it had become cool. So the king, with the teacher's help, carried the wounded man into the hut and laid him on the bed. Lying on the bed, the man closed his eyes and was quiet. And soon the king, too, fell asleep right on the floor, exhausted from the day's work. When the king awoke in the morning, it was long before he could remember where he was or what had happened. And then he saw the injured man sitting up in the bed. "Thank you," said the injured man in a weak voice when he saw that the king was awake and looking at him. "Thank you so much for your help, for without you, I would likely be dead. Now I shall be able to return home safely to my family." The king and the wise teacher helped to prepare some food and water for the injured man and sent him on his way. After a time, the king remembered his intended purpose for his journey. "Wise teacher," said the king, "for the last time, I pray you to answer my questions." "But you have already been answered," said the teacher, looking up at the king. "How answered? What do you mean?" asked the king. "Do you not see?" replied the teacher. "If you had not stayed to help me yesterday and had not dug these beds for me, but had gone on your way, I would have tired and would have never finished these gardens. So the most important time was when you were digging the beds, and I was the most important one, and to do me good was your most important business. Afterward, when that man ran to us, the most important time was when you were attending to him, for if you had not bound up his wounds, he might have died. So he was the most important one, and what you did for him was your most important thing. Remember then, there is only one time that is important, and that is now. The most important one is the one you are with, and the most important thing to do is to do good, because that, my friend, is why we are here."
Friends, the work of this church is supported entirely by donations, by pledges, by special gifts, and by contributions to the offering on Sundays. We can't pass a basket, so we ask you to text to give, or if you prefer, send a check. In these times, your gifts are needed more than ever. Please be generous. First reading today is from Eleanor Roosevelt. One's philosophy is not best expressed in words, it's expressed in the choices one makes. In stopping to think through the meaning of what I've learned, there's much I believe intensely and much I'm unsure of. In the long run, we shape our lives and we shape ourselves. The process never ends till we die. And the choices we make are ultimately our own responsibility. The second reading from Emily Dickinson. If I can stop one heart from breaking, I shall not live in vain. If I can ease one life, the aching, or cool one pain, or help one fainting robin unto his nest again, I shall not live in vain. And thirdly, from Reverend Julie Taylor, Unitarian Universalist, love looks different. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it is not proud. Love bears all things. We know these words, use these words when we refer to one person loving another. Love looks different when we relate to systems. Love looks different in the face of injustice. It's then that love is resistant. Love is defiant. It is not backing down. It is staying in the streets. Love is holding each other and ourselves accountable. Love is challenging because none of us is free till all of us are free. Love is protest. Protest is love. Love bears all things.
Somebody You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'd understand. We all need somebody to lean on. If there is a load you have to bear that you can carry, I'm right up the road. I'll share your load if you just
I don't know about you, but I've been feeling pretty powerless the last few weeks. Not only are we being asked to physically distance ourselves because of a deadly virus moving through the world, but we're now being invited to participate in an uprising to demand an end to police violence in the US. And I'm torn between the two. Do I stay home and protect the people I love and society at large from this virus? Or do I go out with the crowds to protest, to try to protect the people I love and society at large from a different deadly threat? Do I support only peaceful protesters, or do I get behind a movement that uses the destruction of property to force us to pay attention and make a point about lost lives being more important than destroyed property? Who do I listen to about how to proceed? How do I know what's the right thing? And when do I start? What the heck am I supposed to do? What can I do to make a difference? I'm only one person, and I'm a pretty privileged person at that. Well, as we heard in Amy's story, these are big, important questions. When is the most important time to begin? Who is the most important person to listen to? And what is the most important thing to do? And the answers are clear. Now. Now is the only time to begin. The most important person to listen to is the one who needs your help the most. And what is the most important thing to do? It's being helpful to those who need our help. Most white people have been taught that we are the most important people, that later is an okay time to start, and the best thing to do is to make ourselves happy and comfortable. And we are wrong on all accounts. We need to start acting as soon as we can, as soon as we hear from those that are the most vulnerable in our country. Black, Indigenous, people of color, BIPOC, and lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer people, LGBTQ, and disabled people, and especially people who have multiple of these identities. There's a shift in the country right now. All but one of the top 10 New York Times bestsellers in nonfiction are books about understanding racism. 9 out of 10. NASCAR has banned the Confederate flag. People are tearing down Confederate statues that still stand in their towns, and governments are moving to take down the statues before people can even tear them down. Big corporations are realizing that there's a sea change and are making statements about Black Lives Matter. When Amazon makes a stand for Black Lives Matter, you know that they're only saying it to curry favor with their customers. But the fact that their customers would be upset if they didn't make a stand means that it's the popular stance right now. This is just a huge shift in even a few years. Black Lives Matter movement was founded in 2013, only 7 years ago. And now they're a trusted worldwide movement working for a world where Black lives are no longer systematically targeted for demise. So what is the best thing you can do? First and most importantly is to listen to people who are hurting about how they need help. Hopefully you have a relationship with Black people or Black community organizations and have been able to hear what they are saying, what they are asking for. But also don't make more work for individual Black people by asking them what to do, because they are most likely hurting and traumatized once again by so many acts of violence. Do please educate yourself. Buy and read one of those top-selling books about racial inequality, about white supremacy, about how to be an anti-racist. Buy it from an independent bookseller, even better if they're a person of color. If you don't have relationships with Black folks, follow Black Lives Matter groups and other groups. If they host a protest, participate or give money to support bail funds or help buy food and medical supplies. Take time to learn the history of rioting and unrest as a form of forcing social change. Yes, it's dramatic and destructive, and yet, things are changing. Sometimes tearing it down is the right thing to do. Sometimes tearing it down is an act of love. Our children are being taught this. Have you watched Frozen 2? It's a movie about white supremacy and righting injustice. Yeah, it is, really. You should watch it if you haven't, even though I'm going to spoil the ending for you a little bit. I've seen it several times now with a preschooler in my home. That's how we watch things on repeat. In Frozen 2, the filmmakers wanted to continue the story of Elsa and Anna, the sisters who are for the first film, while also making amends to the Sami people, an indigenous people of northern Scandinavia. In the original movie, music from the traditional Sami culture was used without context and without consulting the people it came from. In this film, creators took the time to work extensively with the Sami people to get their input on the fictional indigenous people created for the film. The representatives from the Sami people have publicly expressed their appreciation and pleasure with the new movie. In this sequel, Elsa, the queen of fictional land Arendelle, and Anna, her younger sister, go on a mythic quest to find out about their origins, and especially why Elsa has ice power and Anna doesn't. Along the way, they find out about a conflict that their grandfather created when he was king. He gifted a dam to the indigenous North Aldra people, but his motives, we come to find out, were not to create lasting relationship with the people, but to exploit their resources and to take ownership of their land in order to control the elemental spirits that also live there. At the opening celebration for the dam, their grandfather starts a conflict by killing the unarmed leader of the North Aldra, and then he himself is killed. His betrayal angers the elemental spirits, and they bring a mist down over the enchanted forest, trapping everyone but Elsa and Anna's parents in perpetual fog. They are only saved because their mother, a North Alder girl, saves their father, the Prince of Arendelle. At the climax of the story, Elsa gets frozen, and Anna believes that she has died. Anna finds herself in deep despair. The most important person in her life has gone, the one who has always helped her know what to do. Anna feels lost. How can she go on? She remembers the lessons her parents taught her. When you don't know what to do, do the next right thing. So she does. Anna knows from talking with and relating to the North Aldra people, that they want to be freed from a curse on the enchanted forest. She realizes that the only way to lift the curse and to free them all so they can all see the sky once more is to destroy the dam that her grandfather built. Even though destroying the dam will flood Arendelle and decimate her home. But don't worry, all the people there are already safely evacuated. It's an impossible choice. It's the right thing. So she decides to destroy property to free people. But Anna is only one person, and she isn't magical like her sister. How can any one person make a difference and free an entire people from where they're trapped? She has a radical idea, something dangerous and drastic, but it's the only thing that will work. She incites violence, and it's the right thing. She wakes up the rock spirits, which enrage them, and she gets them to follow her towards the dam where they try to smash her with rocks. They smash the dam instead, and the waters flow down, undoing 50 years of injustice, and the spirits are pleased. Miraculously, Elsa is saved by this act as well. Unfrozen, she saves the buildings of Arendelle and the people of the Enchanted Forest. The sisters find each other. They recognize that they are a bridge between the two cultures, and blah, 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 happily ever after, the end. So yeah, it's still fiction. It's still a Disney movie, but it teaches kids that the right thing isn't always the safe thing, isn't always the easy thing, and it may cost you everything, but it's important to do anyway. Unfortunately, we can't all be Disney princesses and get our happy ending tied up in a bow. Even as we as a country are facing white supremacy culture and Minneapolis is making moves to defund the police, our country's leadership is working to systematically remove rights for trans people. Friday, on the fourth anniversary of the Pulse nightclub shooting, the White House announced that they were removing part of the protections for trans people receiving unbiased health care. This is just one in a series of protections they've rolled back, and I honestly don't know how to speak about it without raging. It is hateful and unconscionable, and I despise it. Every human being on this planet, no matter their gender, no matter their race, no matter their size, no matter their political affiliation, deserve unbiased and affordable health care, period. The end. Obviously, we can't end there. I don't know about you, but I'm still wondering if I'm doing enough. I'm still wondering how I can make a difference. Maybe I made a little difference today talking about this. Maybe I made a little difference posting memes on Facebook and Twitter. Maybe I made a difference by checking with my Black friends and letting them know that I'm thinking of them. Maybe those things just make me feel better and don't actually make a difference. I don't know. All the while, this trauma has reminded Black people of all the ways that this country, this culture of white supremacy, has discounted their joy, has co-opted their culture for white entertainment, has murdered and incarcerated people who look like them at an alarming rate. Tonight, I will show my white son the Sesame Street special dealing with race and injustice, and hope that I can answer his questions in a way that he can understand. A friend yesterday asked me, "Are you teaching your kids about the culture of white supremacy? Are you teaching them about racism? How are you going to help them understand?" And I want to. I want to flatten the curve of white supremacy culture's violence against people of color. I want to stop the transmission of the sickness of white supremacy by inoculating my family. I want to be able to break down systemic oppression, to tear down symbols of hate, and to smash down the dam of white supremacy, even when the waters of justice might destroy my own comfort and sense of safety. I want to, and I'm scared of it. And I don't know how to start. Maybe if I can make moral decisions, if I can keep one heart from breaking, if I can join a group where we hold each other accountable, maybe if I'm brave enough to resist, to be defiant, to demand political change, to teach my children to do better, that will be enough. If I keep doing the next right thing with love, a love that can bear the weight of making justice, maybe that will be enough, and I will have not lived in vain. We will now sing Stone Catcher, written by our very own Carol Collette.
One morning I woke up and I knew what to do. I catch all the stones that everyone threw. I catch all the sorrow that I could in a day. Then I take all the stones and I throw them away. Don't ask why, say we must all be free. Don't ask when, say you can count on me. One morning I woke up and I knew what to do. I catch all the stones that everyone threw. I catch all the anger that I could in a day. Then I take all the stones and I throw them away. Don't ask why, say we must all be free. Don't ask when, say you can count on me. One morning I woke up and I knew what to do. I catch all the stones that everyone threw. I catch all the injustice that I could in a day. Then I take all the stones and I throw them away. Don't ask why, say we must all be free. Don't ask when, say you can count on me. Don't ask why, say we must all be free.
Please join me in the closing words. May peace dwell within our hearts and understanding in our minds. May courage steel our will and love of truth forever guide us. Friends, thank you for joining us. If you're not receiving our email news, go to our website and please sign up. We'll send updates twice a week about online services, groups and gatherings, circles of care, and information about the annual meeting next week. Call or write to us with questions or to ask for help or to offer help. We're sending love to you this morning from St. Paul and Stillwater, from Minneapolis and Woodbury, and from Maple Street in Matamidi. Stay resilient, stay connected, everyone. So be it. See to it. Amen.
Freedom never dies. Can I get you to say, freedom never dies, I say, freedom never dies. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom never dies.
Freedom never dies, I say. Freedom never dies. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom never dies.
It seems I hear Martin's voice from the earth, his blood still cries. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom never dies. It seems I hear Martin's voice from the earth, his blood still cries. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom never dies.
Freedom never dies.
Freedom never dies. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom never dies. Freedom never dies, I say. Freedom never dies. No law can kill the dreams we have.
Freedom never dies.
And then it seems I hear Jimmy's voice from the earth, his blood still cries. No law can kill the dreams we hold. freedom never dies. And it seems I hear Rose's voice from the earth, her blood still cries. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom never dies.
Freedom never dies. Freedom.
Freedom never dies, I say. Freedom never dies. No law can kill the dreams we hold.
Freedom never dies.
One more time, together.
Freedom never dies, I say. Freedom never dies. No law can kill the dreams we hold. Freedom.